This lecture is sponsored by Mundi Pharma, MSD, and Johnson & Johnson. As a first slide, in your practice, I'm asking what is the most common musculoskeletal chronic pain condition that you encounter. In our orthopedic practice, it's usually arthritic pain, specifically pain in degenerative arthritis, low back pain, and compression neuropathies, for example, the carpal tunnel syndrome and deep or vein tenosynovitis, and adhesive capsulitis, popularly known as frozen shoulder. And we also want to define pain in general. And the accepted definition is that it is an unpleasant sensory and emotional experience with actual or potential tissue damage described in terms of such damage. Now, this is somewhat relevant because we will understand here that pain has an emotional layer, and that is the reason why most patients we see in the clinic, particularly in the emergency room, are more in pain because of their agitation, not just because of the actual tissue or bone damage. Now to the common condition, we start with degenerative arthritis. In the Philippines, the prevalence rate of osteoarthritis is pegged at 16%. It is the most common form of arthritis, and it is the most common joint disease. In this slide, we see that the commonly involved sites are the hip, the knees, and the shoulders. Most of the people who have OA are older than the age of 45, and more women are affected than men. This basic review of the pathophysiologic process. And we will see here that with the altered mechanical loading of cartilage, bones, and ligaments, this makes the patient veer away from exercise, leading to chronic muscle weakness, impaired proprioception, and eventually joint laxity. And if we follow the cycle, pretty soon there will be synovial fluid changes leading to the formation of bone spurs or osteophytes and sclerosis of the subchondral area. Eventually, there would be destruction of the matrix and death of cartilage cells. Essentially, there's an imbalance of cytokines, growth factors, the prostaglandin E2, cartilage matrix, neuropeptides, and radical proteases. So we'd like to point out that degenerative arthritis is not a natural phenomenon. In other words, it is not an inevitability as a patient or as a person ages. This slide just compares the osteoarthritis from aging, and unlike aging, osteoarthritis is a progressive and significantly more active as a process. So here is an example of a normal cartilage in a 23-year-old female. This is the distal femur, and we will see that the cartilage is smooth. It's actually slippery, and the color is white. And compared to a patient with severe degenerative arthritis, this is in a 76-year-old female, you can see that the knee is hardly recognizable. There are now severe osteophytes. The cartilage has been denuded. The patella is misshapen, and so is the distal femur, and not very visible would be the proximal tibia. This is the femoral head of an 88-year-old female, and we can see that although she is old, the cartilage is normal. She broke her hip, but she has no arthritis. Compare this to a 66-year-old, much younger patient. This is degenerative arthritis. You can see that the femoral head is misshapen. The cartilage is mostly gone. There are osteophytes. And there are soft areas where the cartilage has been denuded. So this is one proof that aging and osteoarthritis are two different processes. In severe arthritis, the options available are, of course, joint replacement, pharmacologic treatment, rehab, the use of braces and other orthotic devices, and weight loss. It's been found that weight loss as little as 10 pounds will provide some relief from chronic pain in the knees of obese patients. These are classic findings in the arthritic knee. We could see that the joint space is narrowed in the medial compartment. There's the presence of bone spurs, there's subchondral sclerosis, and the round areas below the sclerosis are subchondral cysts. What are the goals of treatment in arthritis? This would be three: to control pain, to minimize disability, and to improve the quality of life. Because as we know, that there is no known cure for arthritis, only treatment. If we divide the non-pharmacologic from the pharmacologic treatment options, we know that we can educate and counsel patients on weight loss, on exercise, provide heat modalities, and provide support aids and appliances. As regards pharmacologic, we are familiar with non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs, the COX-2 inhibitors, weak opioids like tramadol, and preventives, food supplements such as glucosamine and chondroitin sulfate. Viscous supplementation is popular. We are able to inject hyaluronic acid in the knees with good results, and also the use of intra-articular corticosteroids for inflammation. The endpoint, of course, of arthritis would be the replacement of joints, and we are able to replace joints regularly and successfully in the knees, the hips, the shoulders, the cervical spine, the elbows and the wrists, and ankles. The other more common orthopedic condition that we see in practice would be low back pain, and it is characterized by a constellation of factors causing pain in the lumbosacral area, and back-related symptoms we call sciatica that impair activities of daily living, usually lasting for less than 3 months. And it is so common that 90% of people experience back pain in their lifetime, and at least half will have a recurrent episode. It accounts for 25% of direct costs of absenteeism at work, and accounts for 86% of compensation costs. It's the number one cause of disability under 45 years old. And the risk factors are low job satisfaction, monotonous or repetitious work, adverse employer-employee relations, and frequent lifting. So in Manila, we usually get a lot of OFW or overseas foreign workers, usually seamen, and with low back pain as the chief complaint, we find out through their history that they usually lift heavy loads regularly without knowledge on how to do it correctly. Now, this slide shows you that most of low back pain is mechanical in origin, close to 97%, and the rest would be due to cancer or infection. We realize that most patients with low back pain do not need further investigations because 70 to 90% of acute low back pain may resolve in 1 month or less. However, there are some red flags. In general, if the patient is unable to improve with conservative treatment for 4 to 6 weeks, if the pain is unrelenting at rest or at night, and if there is progressive motor or sensory deficit. We think of cancer if the patient is more than 50, if there's a family history of cancer, or the patient has current cancer in other areas, and of course, unexplained weight loss. So in the Philippines, we still have tuberculosis of the bones and joints. We think of this in presentations where there are fever or chills, recent infection, UTI or skin, immunosuppression, and the use of IV drug use. This would be illegal drug use. So in the area of infection, it could be bacterial, viral, and particularly in the bacterial infection, there's a high risk of getting disease, tuberculosis disease, particularly in the spine, which we call Pott's disease. In fractures, usually the patient is more than 50 with a history of osteoporosis. It could happen, of course, with significant trauma and with weakened bones due to chronic oral steroid use in conditions like allergies or kidney disease or pulmonary disease. Other red flags, Cauda equini syndrome, which is an orthopedic emergency, presents as urinary incontinence or retention, saddle anesthesia, decrease in anal or tone or fecal incontinence, and weakness of the lower extremities. in acute abdominal aneurysm, the patient is more than 60 with abdominal pulsating mass and pain at rest. Our investigations begin with the simple X-ray, followed by CAT scan or MRI, and much later, bone scan if needed, and lab tests. In a plain lumbar X-ray, lumbosacral X-ray, we're able to identify trauma, compression fractures, dislocation, degenerative changes. We're able to check the spinal curves on AP if there's a presence of adult scoliosis. And with the lysis, we can identify end stages of malignancies. These are some classic findings via X-ray alone. There's spondylolisthesis disease in which, for example, in this slide, there is a forward or anterior slide of the vertebra in relation to the inferior one. In this case, L4 over L5. A compression fracture is evident in the L4 vertebra in the middle picture. And there is a fracture dislocation in the extreme right slide. We can also find degenerative changes. This is lumbar spondylosis on the left, and the so-called bamboo spine, which is the ankylosing spondylitis on the right side. However, a plain X-ray is not highly sensitive or specific. It cannot rule out serious disease, and it's not good at identifying muscles, ligaments, and nerves, in which case the physician can request an MRI because it provides more detailed images of soft tissues like the discs and the nerve roots. So the MRI is useful in identifying spinal stenosis, disc bulges, or disc protrusions and extrusions, spinal tumors, infections, compressive lesions, and the dreaded called the equina syndrome. In a CAT scan, we like to focus more on the bony spinal pathology, and it's useful for identifying trauma, particularly if one is planning on surgery. In osteomyelitis and infection and tumors, there would be areas of lysis. And there are cases where the MRI is contraindicated in patients with pacemakers or metallic clips. The downside of the CT scan is, of course, there is more radiation exposure. A bone scan is useful in osteomyelitis or infection, a bony neoplasm or occult fractures. However, it is unlikely to demonstrate bone changes when radiographs and the ESR are normal. The bone scan is more sensitive than X-rays in detecting metastasis, Paget's disease, ankylosing spondylitis, trauma, and certain tumors like the benign osteoid stroma. We ordered lab tests with the presence of the red flag signs as mentioned, with suspicions of malignancy or infection, and metabolic reasons for the orthopedic pain, such as gout. So the tests are the basic complete blood count, the ESR, the C-reactive protein, and others like HLA-B27. We know this to be positive in patients with AS, but only up to 95% of ankylosing spondylitis patients. We now go to the symptomatic treatment of orthopedic pain conditions. And the aims are to relieve pain, to improve the quality of life, and to treat the underlying cause. We mentioned that the non-pharmacologic treatments are activity modification, physical rehabilitation, and manipulation. In the use of drugs, we are familiar with the NSAIDs. Opiates can be used for severe pain, and tricyclic antidepressant drugs can be used to improve mood, for better sleep, and for pain control. So when do we refer to a specialist? When there is no significant improvement in 4 to 6 weeks of conservative treatment, and if we are proactive in avoiding misdiagnosis and inappropriate treatments. We can refer to an orthopedic surgeon or a spine specialist if there is a suspicion of the cauda equina syndrome, if there's intractable pain, if serious spinal pathology is suspected, and if there is progressive motor loss, sensory loss, and absence or increased reflexes. So these are the more common spinal surgery interventions, such as posterior decompression with instrumentation and interbody fusion. You can see in the center and right slides the use of pedicular screws and cages in between the vertebral bodies. The NSAIDs, of course, would be the group that contain mefenamic acid, ketoprofen, ibuprofen. In the market, there are just two COX-2 inhibitors that are available, celecoxib and etoricoxib. The weak opioids we know as codeine, oxycodone, tramadol, and the strong opioid example would be morphine. This slide just tells us that their findings as far back as 25 years ago is that pain is unrelieved up to 90% of cancer patients, and that fewer than 50% receive adequate treatment. The observation is that all types of pain are inadequately treated, be it acute or chronic, related to malignant or non-malignant etiologies. Again, to emphasize in this slide that pain is undertreated. In a comparison of a 10-year interval, any pain is now previously 70% treated, now it is up to 82%. These are the barriers to pain management: administrative and regulatory barriers, healthcare provider attitudes and misconceptions, patient factors like avoiding pain meds because of GI symptoms, and cultural barriers, for example, the idea of mortification or trying to use pain for spiritual gain or purpose. What is the impact of the use of NSAIDs? With a prescription of about 70 million per year, there are still 13 million chronic users, with the most common side effect being dyspepsia in 20% and gastric ulcers in 10%. So up to 100,000 can have upper GI bleed, with mortality of 5 to 10%. In this Philippine study, in recent years, the most widely used form of analgesics would be the coxibs because of their proven efficacy and safety. And it appears to be the top prescribed medication by recall among Filipino surgeons. So we have an ethical obligation to manage pain and relieve suffering because it is at the core of a healthcare professional's commitment. We thank our sponsors again, MSD, Mundi Pharma, and Johnson & Johnson Philippines. Thank you to all.
Thank you very much, Briggs. We now move to our question and answer portion for this webinar. You can forward your questions now through
chat box
the site, and I will monitor them and pass them on to our speaker.
Ask the first question.
So to start things off, I'd like to ask Briggs, in terms of viscosupplementation for arthritis, I think initially the meta-analyses were not very supportive of its efficacy. But from reviews of previous later studies, I think the trend is the longer you use it, it tends to be more effective compared to the previous studies wherein the length of time of its use was not yet quite documented. Mm-hmm. This is something that you would more or less agree to, because I think it is an option that our patients look for even now. Those who are not quite for surgery yet, but even sometimes for those who are already surgically injured, but they refuse to have surgery. And they know about these viscosupplementation techniques already, and they actually ask for it. How do you use them now?
My experience is, first as a background, hyaluronic acid is usually purified protein from a rooster's comb. And the efficacy of intra-articular injection of hyaluronic acid depends also on the severity of the arthritis. So it works best in early to moderate arthritis and worse in end stage or severe degenerative arthritis. In fact, I discourage patients who are already ripe for joint replacement to just save their money for surgery rather than viscosupplementation. Also, it helps to inject the hyaluronic acid together with a short-acting or a medium-acting local anesthetic like bupivacaine or lidocaine.
Okay, thank you. I'd just like to mention at this point that as of 12:46, we have 30 participants, and the breakdown will be as follows. One from Canada, I hope this is more than for their classmate. Two from Hong Kong. I think these are, there is a conference going on right now that some of our Filipino colleagues are joining. One from Japan, we know this is our best week, just in the meantime. 23 here from the Philippines and 3 from the US. So thank you very much for joining us for our inaugural. your webinar. And this is presently
next.
The count is about 30. So we're looking for any questions.
24 online plus 30.
24 online plus
30 live stream.
30 in the live stream. So that's a pretty good number for ending the inaugural webinar. So if you have any questions for Rick's this point. So being orthopedic surgeons, we of course need to deal with the surgical management of the end stage conditions. I don't know if this is a practical question, but I'm sure here in the Philippines, people would like to know more or less how much a joint replacement, especially like for the knee or for the hip, might come out to, because we know that this is still a limiting factor in terms of people getting the procedures done here, because we are not a socialized medicine country. So maybe you can give us an idea, Riggs, as to maybe how much the implants are and all of that, just so that we have a better idea of what we're talking about. Let's say joint replacements, one knee now.
In terms of pesos, probably it's less than $500,000 in pesos. But since we, for our poor compatriots, I'd like to plug the program of our national social insurance, which is PhilHealth. PhilHealth has a currently a Z package, which is piloted at the Philippine Orthopedic Center. If the PhilHealth member is qualified, he's able to get the implant for free. The implant would range from 100 to 200,000 depending on the brand and on the type of metal alloy that is used. The cheapest being stainless steel and the most expensive being titanium.
Another thing, Rick's usually that I think the Filipino population is quite worried about is also surgery for spinal problems that you have mentioned also. Some would rather suffer the condition rather than undergo surgery. Maybe we can just enumerate certain red flags in the physical exam or what the patient might be feeling, so that they can be better guided as to where they might really need surgery for some of these spinal conditions that they mentioned.
So in the natural history for a slip disc or disc protrusion, this starts as low back pain associated with radiculopathy or electric shooting pain to one side of the lower extremity or both sides, depending on how the disc protrudes, either centrally to the left or to the right. So this by itself is a warning sign that there is probably a disc problem, in which case further investigation is needed. And I believe a patient needs to see a doctor immediately if there is worsening sensory and motor changes. For example, if the extreme case that everyone should know about would be the coda equina syndrome, in which there is sudden loss of urinary and anal tone, in which the result would be incontinence or retention of both urine and feces. So that's an emergency. Well, whether the patient would like it or not, the doctor would like to operate because some of the changes in Cauda equine syndrome may be irreversible.
Okay, thank you, Griggs. We have a question here from one of the participants here in the center itself, Dr. Ray Salidel. And he'd like to ask a question.
Well, a while ago about the surgery, about millions of pesos, you know, families, most of the topics we have mentioned, osteoarthritis and low back pain, are the most common pains that we encounter in our practice. But conservatively, as much as possible, we try to shy away from giving NSAIDs and pain medicines because of the fear of gastritis and ulcer and, you know, bleeding and NSAID nephropathy. Okay, so how great is the impact of lifestyle modifications in the management of osteoarthritis and low back pain?
One of the risk factors in arthritis is weight gain, particularly obesity. And there are studies to show that as little as 10 pounds, losing 10 pounds in obese patients would relieve chronic knee pain. So I agree that lifestyle modification would help a lot in preventing or delaying surgery. Diet-wise, there are sectors that believe that arthritis is inflammatory in nature and it's triggered by certain foods. However, what is clear is that if the cause of the arthritis is metabolic, particularly in the overload of uric acid crystals in the joints leading to gout, the obvious lifestyle modification there would be to provide a low purine diet. So if the uric acid is controlled, then acute gout attacks would be lessened. And the problem with uncontrolled gout is that it eventually leads to gouty arthritis, also destroying joints, also necessitating surgery as a last option.
Physiology and the osteoarthritis. And you mentioned that this OA is more active and active process, and it's progressive.
Progressive.
That's what you showed. Does it mean that, because I believe that osteoarthritis or degenerative is wear and tear. So the more, like among the athletes, where they usually use their knees, their ankles, and their, would you say that being more active will make this person prone to have this osteoarthritis?
Yeah, our studies show that you have to be predisposed to arthritis. So there's a genetic factor involved in arthritis, and I always tell my patients that that you may grow older, you may age, but you may not necessarily get. We'll have old patients, we'll have the elderly running marathons.
And vice versa, you have a 40-ish or 50-ish old already.
Exactly. Yeah. And when we talk of athletes having arthritis in the future, this is another aspect of arthritis. Another subset called post-traumatic arthritis. So you can get arthritis because you actually damage your joints early on.
But not the overuse.
Not the overuse. The overuse would usually reflect in your muscles, tendons, and ligaments. If you are not predisposed to arthritis genetically, there may be no wear and tear.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Dr. Paul.
Thank you very much.
Dr. I think we have some questions that are not coming out of on our on our panels, but have been forwarded to us. One of them is from a classmate we met in Sanaa, in the US. She has actually two questions. Let's bring the one about glucosamine and chondroitin sulfate supplements. What do you think about them, Briggs? How do you use them in practice?
So depending on where you are, glucosamine sulfate and chondroitin sulfate can be a drug, which means it's prescribed, or it could be a food supplement, which can means it can be bought over the counter. Now, it's been proven that glucosamine and chondroitin sulfate do not reverse arthritis, and their primary purpose is to delay the progression of arthritis. And studies have shown that they can delay the progression of arthritis by as much as 3 to 5 years. So if you're due for a knee replacement at 70 with the regular use of chondroitin sulfate, you may be able to delay it.
Okay, thank you. Linette has another question about degenerative lumbar degenerative disc disease. And up to what age can you still surgically repair lumbar degenerative disc disease? I think this means not a fusion. And are there any non-surgical or less invasive options? She's talking about lumbar degenerative disc disease.
Hmm. The current management of degenerative arthritis in the lumbar spine or the lumbosacral spine would still be decompression in the form of a wide laminectomy, a foraminotomy, and insertion of pedicular screws with fusion. So, unfortunately, in the elderly, you also have to deal with the comorbidity of porotic bone. So this is the reason why, as you decompress the spine, you have to look for ways to stabilize it. And this is the reason that decompression or removing bone so that the nerves will be able to be unimpinged go hand in hand with providing more support in bone that is originally weak, bone that is weak in the first place because of osteoporosis. So there are cases in which if the bone is not yet porotic by and confirmed by DEXA scanning or DEXA screening, you may be able to get away with a simple laminotomy or laminectomy. But this would be on the proviso that you explain to the patient that it is a stopgap procedure and she may need further surgery if the symptoms persist or if the signs worsen.
Another question, again from our classmate, Edmond Yaku. How has anti-osteoporosis treatment with bisphosphonates impacted long-term quality of life versus the known side effects? Medyo off
panel. Yeah, well, for the first few years when bisphosphonates were introduced in the form of, as we know them, ibendronic acid and alendronate, for example, they were the darling of the orthopedic community until studies came out when they actually contributed to osteoclastic activity, leading to some bone loss, for example, in the mandible. These are extreme cases where case reports were written up. So my quick answer is that bisphosphonates would still be a godsend to osteoporotic patients, provided that the clinician carefully monitors the bisphosphonate use by regular monitoring of the DEXA scan. So using the WHO graph on normal osteopenic and osteoporotic bone, I believe that once the patient is able to reach the normal bone density, then the bisphosphonate can be tapered off. Usually this happens in a period of 2 years. The other option, of course, is the use of strontium 9 ranilate. I won't mention the brand name, because daily use of strontium ranilate appears to have the extra benefit of not only preventing the loss of bone, and it, because it also claims that it deposits new bone, as it also prevents bone loss. So it's a little different. The mechanism is a little different in strontium ranilate.
I think that Emma is also referring to the incidence of atypical fractures in the proximal femur. Anyway, you also answered that. We have another question here, this time from, again, our classmate, Ricky Tinkos. What are the common pediatric joint pain conditions, and how do we work up and manage these conditions?
Well, pediatric, of course, because of the activity level of children, we begin with realizing that they are accident prone, and usually it would still be the fractures, dislocations are rare. You seldom see dislocations in children, because before a bone dislocates, it will fracture, or the ligaments or the tendons are so flexible or elastic. So that's one, fractures. Usual accidents like abrasions and lacerations in children who are always playing. In the Philippines, the worrisome chronic pain conditions would be the pain at night, night sweats, which would seek weight loss, which would signify or alert us to Pott's disease. We still have many cases at the Philippine Orthopedic Center of untreated tuberculosis of the spine. The patient would come in with either paraparesis or paraplegia. Sometimes, most of the time, you will see there is kyphosis, kyphotic deformities, signifying that the anterior vertebra in the thoracic area has collapsed. So we divide pediatric orthopedic pain into acute and chronic. And chronic, we will further subdivide into usually disease, such as infection, and of course tumors, pediatric tumors.
Okay, thank you. Here we have a question from Renee Marie Gula, and she asks, Dr. Pujante, if the patient has sciatica, do you suggest or prefer the symptoms of sciatica?
Neural structures. So the EMG NCV might not be as reliable. And the other reason we we order the EMG NCD is as a diagnostic prior to surgery, because in this study they are able to localize where the actual impingement is occurring. This is also relevant in upper extremity conditions with nerve impingement. So we wish to find out if the impingement is occurring in the cervical area, in the cubital or anticubital area, or in the wrist. Sometimes you are treating a carpal tunnel syndrome patient, you misdiagnose the patient as having a peripheral nerve problem, when in fact the injury is way up high in the cervical nerve roots. So these are indications for using this diagnostic, very useful diagnostic study, but we caution that they should be used in chronic conditions, not in the acute stage.
Okay. Thank you again for that question. Just as an update, as of 1:13, we have 32 participants in Canada 1, Hong Kong 2, Japan 1, Philippines 25, and US 3.
And KPI 20.
20 in MKTI also right now, who are doing the live stream. Okay, I think we're actually over time already.
Are there any more questions?
Are there any more questions that we have missed? Here, one more. How often do you see fractures in bed-bound patients? As an example, pediatric patients on chronic ventilator support, and most of them having osteoporosis from disuse.
Yeah. So, disuse osteoporosis is a problem not only in bed-bound pediatric patients, but also in bed-bound elderly patients. And in osteoporotic fractures are actually we also classify as pathologic fractures, because you need only minimal trauma to break the bone. So it is a common problem, and the solution in this particular problem is of course to provide daily physical therapy. So the patient must be exercised even in bed by a qualified physical therapist who will make sure that the joints are kept supple, the muscles are kept strong, so that there is enough muscle mass to prevent direct injury to bone.
Okay. It's already 1:20 by my watch, so we are actually over time. But we thank you very much for your participation today.
Tweet and ask your questions. Tweet your questions.
You can still tweet your questions now, and we can still send it to our speaker. So as a summary of the session, Dr. Briggs discussed the different common musculoskeletal pathologic conditions that even the general practitioners in the medical profession can diagnose and can treat on their own, and then when maybe to do specialist referrals for the other conditions that might need more than just pharmacology treatment. So if you still have any questions, they can be tweeted.
Hashtag
UPM web. question, and Dr. Briggs will answer it. So we just also like to give you a teaser for some of the upcoming webinars that we have planned. This one is for July 1, and that's also Wednesday, also around the same time.
Yes.
And this will be given by our classmate, Dr. Lea Antoniselli, and the topic will be measuring quality healthcare. Okay, so keep that.
Is it there?
Here. Okay, see that? Again, registration is free and through the same site.
Next slide, George.
And then
there.
This one is for August 5, also around the same time. So for these next two ones, it's the first Wednesday of the month, and this one on August will be updates on the management of diabetes mellitus. So please note the dates and Please watch out for announcements in your emails, for follow-up messages, also in terms of feedback and for your CME units. And once we've received your responses, we will also send you more resources on this session. So thank you very much for joining us.
Check your emails,
and we'd just like to also again thank our sponsors.
Okay.
I am the presenter.
Okay. Yeah.
Yes. Mundi Pharma, MSD, and Johnson & Johnson for their assistance with us for our first webinar. And we hope to see you all in our next webinar. Again, note the dates. Measuring Quality of Healthcare on July 1 with Dr. Dale Anthony Selly.